Hello guys, this is Indian Medico and in this video we'll see a review of obstetrics. Let us see about diagnosis of pregnancy. First let us see about signs and symptoms of early pregnancy. Amenorrhea, nausea and vomiting and breast tenderness are the symptoms of pregnancy. Now let us see about signs of pregnancy. There are two named signs. They are Chadwick sign and Hagar sign. Chadwick sign is bluish discoloration and congested appearance of vagina. Hagar sign is softening of lower segment of uterus. Fetal heart tone can be detected by Doppler at around 10 weeks. Ultrasound can detect gestational sac by 5 weeks and cardiac activity by 6 weeks. This picture shows eccentrically placed intrauterine gestational sac at around 6 weeks post conception. This picture shows a pseudosac. A pseudosac will be seen in ectopic pregnancy. It is basically collection of blood or fluid within the endometrial cavity. Now let us see about the signs of fetal viability during pregnancy. Fetal heart activity, fetal movement detection and embryo or fetus ultrasonic recognition. These are the signs of viability during pregnancy. Now let us see about beta HCG. It is detectable 8 to 9 days after ovulation. The doubling time in early pregnancy is 2 days. It peaks in pregnancy at around 8 to 10 weeks. Human chorionic gonadotropin quantification is helpful in diagnosing ectopic pregnancy, monitoring neoplastic trophoblastic disease and in screening fetal aneuploidy. Now let us see about dating of pregnancy. Gestational age, that is GA, or estimated date of delivery is age of fetus from last menstrual period or LMP. Now let us see about Naegeli's rule. The estimated date of delivery is calculated as LMP plus 9 months and 7 days. We can also calculate it using the formula EDD equal to LMP plus 7 days minus 3 months plus 1 year. Both are the same. This is applicable only when there are regular 28 day cycles. The most common cause for size for dates discrepancy is inaccurate dating. Now let us see about physiologic changes in pregnancy. First let us see about cardiovascular system. There will be increase in heart rate and stroke volume leading to an increase in cardiac output. There will be a systolic ejection murmur which is normal in pregnancy. It is important to remember that a diastolic murmur is never a normal finding in pregnancy. There will be decrease in blood pressure, especially diastolic blood pressure. It will be lowest at around 24 weeks. Now let us see about the respiratory changes. There will be increase in tidal volume and minute ventilation. There will be decrease in total lung capacity. This is because of elevation of diaphragm due to pregnancy. There will be increase in total body oxygen consumption. There will be hyperventilation, which optimizes carbon dioxide and oxygen transfer between mother and fetus. Now let us see about gastrointestinal changes. There will be nausea and vomiting, reflux esophagitis, hemorrhoids and cholestasis. Now let us see about renal changes. There will be increase in glomerular filtration rate, decrease in blood urea nitrogen and creatinine. There will be urinary stasis and asymptomatic bacteriuria in around 5% of pregnancies. Now let us see about hematological changes. There will be decrease in hematocrit. This is because the plasma volume increases by 40%. This is more than the increase in RBC volume. Pregnancy is an hypercoagulable state. There will be increase in clotting factors, decrease in protein S, increase in venous stasis and endothelial damage. Now let us see about dermatologic changes. Increase in estrogen will lead to formation of spider angiomata and palmar erythema. There will be increase in melanocyte stimulating hormone leading to hyperpigmentation of nipples, abdominal midline and face. Hyperpigmentation of abdominal midline is called linea nigra and hyperpigmentation of face is called as chloasma or melasma. This picture shows a case of chloasma or melasma. Now let us see about endocrine changes. There will be increase in human chorionic gonadotropin, human placental lactogen, that is HPL. It is an insulin antagonist with diabetogenic effect. There will also be increase in progesterone, estrogen, thyroid binding globulin, T3 and T4 and prolactin. The patient will still be in euthyroid state. And let us see about prenatal care. In first prenatal visit, we have to do the following tests: complete blood count, Rh factor, antibody screen, pap smear, gonorrhea and chlamydia cultures, urine analysis and urine culture, rubella, syphilis, hepatitis B and HIV. Folate supplementation will help reduce the risk of neural tube defects. After 20 weeks gestation, the fundalite should increase at the rate of 1 cm per week. Now let us see about teratogens. Teratogens can lead to structural abnormalities when a pregnant woman is exposed to them at around 3 to 8 weeks of gestational age. This is because this is the organogenesis phase. ACE inhibitors can lead to renal dysgenesis, which will lead to oligohydramnios, pulmonary hypoplasia and limb contractures. Tetracycline can lead to discolored teeth and enamel hypoplasia. Aminoglycosides can lead to acoustic nerve damage, which in turn can lead to deafness. Oral hypoglycemics can lead to neonatal hypoglycemia. Phenytoin can lead to fetal hydantoin syndrome, which causes craniofacial and limb defects and mental deficiencies. Valproic acid can lead to spina bifida. Isotretinoin can lead to craniofacial abnormalities like small ear, CNS abnormalities, cardiac and thymus defects. Indomethacin can lead to constriction of ductus arteriosus. Diethyl stilbestrol or DES can lead to clear cell vaginal cancer and cervical or uterine malformations in female offspring. Thalidomide can lead to limb reduction defects. Alcohol will cause fetal alcohol syndrome, which includes craniofacial defects like absent philtrum, flattened nasal bridge and microphthalmia. It can also cause growth restriction, brain defects, cardiac and spinal defects. Tobacco can lead to growth restriction. Exposure to radiation can lead to growth restriction, CNS defects and leukemia. Now let us see about gestational diabetes mellitus. It is the most common medical complication of pregnancy. Risk factors for gestational diabetes mellitus include pregnancy greater than 25 years of age, obesity, positive family history of diabetes mellitus, previous infant with birth weight greater than 4000 gram and previous history of polyhydramnios. Now let us see about the diagnosis of gestational diabetes mellitus. We can do screening test with glucose challenge test and glucose tolerance test. Now let us see about glucose challenge test. In this case, we give 50 gram glucose irrespective of last meal and measure the blood glucose at around 1 hour. If the 1 hour blood glucose is greater than or equal to 140 milligram per deciliter, it is highly suggestive of gestational diabetes mellitus and the patient should be subjected to oral glucose tolerance test. Nowadays, GCT is not done in most of the hospitals. We directly do OGTT in second trimester. Now let us see about OGTT, that is oral glucose tolerance test. In this case, we advise the patient overnight fasting and measure fasting glucose. Then we either give 75 gram glucose or 100 gram glucose. IAD PSG recommends 75 gram OGTT, whereas ACOG recommends 100 gram OGTT. Now let us see about the cutoff values for OGTT. According to IAD PSG, for 75 gram glucose tolerance test, these are the cutoff values: fasting greater than or equal to 92, 1 hour glucose greater than or equal to 180, 2 hour glucose greater than or equal to 153. If at least one of them is above the cutoff value, we can diagnose gestational diabetes mellitus. Now let us see about ACOG cutoff values: fasting greater than or equal to 95, 1 hour glucose greater than or equal to 180, 2 hour glucose greater than or equal to 155 and 3 hour glucose greater than or equal to 140. Gestational diabetes mellitus can be diagnosed if 2 or more of these values are above the cutoff values. Now let us see about the management of gestational diabetes mellitus. Diabetic diet and insulin can be given if necessary. Ultrasound should be done for fetal growth assessment. Non-stress test should be started at around 30 to 32 weeks if requiring hypoglycemics. Now let us see about white classification for gestational diabetes mellitus. Gestational diabetes mellitus can be classified as GDM A1 and GDM A2. GDM A1 is diet controlled, whereas GDM A2 requires hypoglycemics. It is important to remember that many women with gestational diabetes mellitus will develop overt diabetes mellitus after their pregnancy. Now let us see a clinical case of gestational diabetes mellitus. A 30-year-old primi gravida, obese female at 32 weeks gestation presents for her first prenatal visit. Physical examination shows fundal height 37 cm and fetal heart tones are within normal limit. Ultrasound reveals amniotic fluid index of 27, that is, there is polyhydramnios. It is important to remember that gestational diabetic mellitus is a risk factor for polyhydramnios. With single intrauterine pregnancy, 75 g OGTT was done and 2-hour glucose was 210 mg/dL. This is a classical case of gestational diabetes mellitus. Now let us see about pre-existing diabetes mellitus complicating pregnancy. Let us see about the management. We have to give insulin. We have to check baseline TSH, baseline ophthalmology examination and baseline preeclampsia labs. We also have to monitor HbA1c. Ultrasound and maternal serum AFP, that is alpha fetal protein check, should be done at 16 to 20 weeks. Fetal echocardiogram should be done at 20 weeks. This is to detect any fetal abnormalities. Twice weekly non-stress test should be done starting at 30 to 32 weeks. Elective cesarean section is indicated if the fetal weight is greater than 4500 g. Now let us see about the maternal complications of diabetes mellitus. Preeclampsia or eclampsia, there is a 2x increased risk of preeclampsia in women with diabetes mellitus. Hyperglycemia, retinopathy and diabetic ketoacidosis. Now let us see about the fetal complications of diabetes mellitus in pregnancy. Macrosomia, that is baby weighing greater than 4500 g. Cardiac defects, caudal regression, that is malformations associated with poor glucose control, polyhydramnios, hypoglycemia secondary to hyperinsulinemia and intrauterine death are the various fetal complications of diabetes mellitus. Now let us see about the obstetrical complications of diabetes mellitus, preterm labor and shoulder dystocia. Now let us see about hypertension in pregnancy. First let us discuss definitions. The definition of chronic hypertension is blood pressure greater than or equal to 140/90 before pregnancy or diagnosed before 20 weeks of gestational age. This blood pressure should be measured on two occasions at least 4 hours apart. What is pregnancy induced hypertension? Pregnancy induced hypertension is blood pressure greater than or equal to 140/90 on two occasions at least 4 hours apart diagnosed after 20 weeks of gestation. Now let us see about preeclampsia. Preeclampsia is systolic blood pressure greater than or equal to 140 mm of mercury or diastolic blood pressure greater than or equal to 90 mm of mercury on at least two occasions at least 4 hours apart after 20 weeks gestation in a previously normotensive patient, that is pregnancy induced hypertension plus the new onset of one or more of the following: proteinuria greater than or equal to 0.3 g in a 24 hour urine specimen, or PCR, that is protein creatinine ratio greater than or equal to 0.3 in a random urine specimen, or a dipstick greater than or equal to 2 positive if a quantitative measurement is unavailable. Platelet count less than 1 lakh per microliter, serum creatinine greater than 1.1 mg per deciliter or doubling of the creatinine concentration in the absence of other renal disease, liver transaminases at least twice the upper limit of the normal concentrations, pulmonary edema, cerebral or visual symptoms like new onset and persistent headaches, blurred vision, flashing lights or sparks and scotoma. What is preeclampsia with severe features? To diagnose preeclampsia with severe features, it should have one of the following conditions. Blood pressure should be greater than or equal to 160/110 mm of mercury, or platelet count less than 1 lakh per microliter, or serum creatinine greater than 1.1 mg per deciliter, or liver transaminases twice the upper limit, or right upper quadrant pain, or pulmonary edema, or cerebral or visual symptoms. If any of these are present, we can classify it as preeclampsia with severe features. Now let us see about eclampsia. Eclampsia is preeclampsia with seizures. Now let us see about HELLP syndrome. HELP is an acronym for hemolytic anemia, elevated liver enzymes and low platelets. Now let us see a clinical case of HELP syndrome. 30-year-old primary gravida at 32 weeks gestation presents with malaise, nausea and vomiting and abdominal tenderness. Physical examination shows blood pressure 150/98, right upper quadrant tenderness. Workup shows platelets 70,000 cells per millimeter cube, elevated liver function test and peripheral blood shows hemolysis. This is a case of HELP syndrome. Now let us see about signs and symptoms of severe preeclampsia or eclampsia. There can be headache, blurred vision, epigastric pain, hyperreflexia and clonus. If all these are present, we should strongly suspect preeclampsia, severe preeclampsia or eclampsia. Now let us see about risk factors for preeclampsia. Multifetal gestation, nulliparity, that is primary gravida, positive family history, maternal age less than 20 or greater than 35 years of age, chronic hypertension, gestational diabetes mellitus and SLE. Now let us see about management of mild preeclampsia with immature fetus. In this case, we have to advise bed rest, monitoring of BP, monitoring of weight and serial 24-hour urine protein levels. Preeclampsia labs should be ordered. These include creatinine, uric acid, complete blood count and liver function test. Now let us see about management of severe preeclampsia and eclampsia. We have to give magnesium sulfate until 24 hours postpartum. We have to normalize BP and delivery. If fetal or maternal deterioration is seen at any gestational age, we have to induce labor, because delivery is the definitive treatment of preeclampsia and eclampsia. Now let us see about magnesium sulfate regimens used for treating preeclampsia and eclampsia. We'll see about two regimens, Pritchard regimen and Dhaka regimen. First, let us see about Pritchard regimen. We give 4 gram magnesium sulfate as 20 ml of 20% solution, slow IV over 5 minutes. Plus, we give 10 gram of magnesium sulfate intramuscularly. We give 5 gram, that is 10 ml of 50% solution into each buttock. This is the loading dose. For maintenance dose, we give 5 gram magnesium sulfate every 4 hours intramuscularly. Before giving maintenance dose, we have to check respiratory rate. It should be greater than 14 per minute. Knee jerk should be present and urine output in the previous 4 hours should be greater than 100 ml. Now let us see about Dhaka regimen. The intravenous loading dose is the same as Pritchard regimen. In Dhaka regimen, we give only 6 gram intramuscular as loading dose. That is, we give only 3 gram into each buttock. In Dhaka regimen, we give only 2.5 gram magnesium sulfate intramuscularly as maintenance dose. Now let us see a case of preeclampsia. 19-year-old primary gravida with twin gestation at 35 weeks gestation presents with headaches and blurred vision. Blood pressure is 148/102. There is facial edema. There is no abdominal tenderness or hyperreflexia. Workup shows two positive protein on urine dipstick. This is a case of preeclampsia. Now let us see another clinical case. 18-year-old primary gravida at 22 weeks gestation presents with persistent nausea and vomiting. Physical examination shows poor skin turgor, dry mucous membranes. Workup shows hypochloremic alkalosis. Thyroid function test, liver function test, amidase and lipase are all within normal limit. This is a classical case of hyperemesis gravidarum. Now let us see about the treatment of hyperemesis gravidarum. Intravenous fluids, pyridoxin, thiamine, antiemetics like promethazine or doxylamine can be given to treat hyperemesis gravidarum. It is important to remember that 10% of maternal mortalities are due to pulmonary embolism. Now let us see about the treatment for deep venous thrombosis or pulmonary embolism in pregnancy. Heparin or low molecular weight heparin can be given. Warfarin should be avoided in pregnancy. The drug of choice for hyperthyroidism in pregnancy is propylthioaerosine. Now let us see about asymptomatic bacteria. It should be treated in pregnant women. This is because 25% of pregnant women with asymptomatic bacteria will develop acute symptomatic infection if untreated. It can lead to acute pyelonephritis. It is the most common cause of septic shock in pregnancy. Let us see about the management of acute pyelonephritis. Hospitalization, urine and blood culture, intravenous hydration, intravenous antibiotics, urine culture 1 to 2 weeks after completion of treatment, that is test of cure. Now let us see about management of HIV positive pregnant women. We have to give azithromycin after 14 weeks gestation age through labor for the mother. Azithromycin should also be given for newborn. Vertical transmission of HIV on azithromycin prophylaxis is only 8%, whereas without azithromycin prophylaxis it is 25%. The mode of delivery: if the HIV viral load is greater than 1000 copies per ml at 36 weeks gestation age, is a scheduled cesarean section. If there is active herpes lesions during the intrapartum period, we have to proceed to cesarean section. Now let us see about group B streptococcus infection in pregnancy. Screening should be done at 36 weeks of gestation age. We have to take a swab from lower vagina and rectum through sphincter. The drug of choice for group B streptococcus positive patients during intrapartum period is penicillin. Antibiotic treatment is indicated when group B streptococcus status is unknown, gestation age is greater than 36 weeks, and there is rupture of membranes for greater than 18 hours, and intrapartum temperature is greater than 38 degrees Celsius, or when there is history of group B streptococcus positive urine culture during current pregnancy, and when there is history of previous infant with group B streptococcus sepsis. Now let us see about chorioamnionitis. It is infection of the amniotic fluid. It is the most common cause of neonatal sepsis. It should be treated with broad spectrum antibiotics and delivery. Now let us see about obstetrical complications. The differential diagnosis for bleeding in first trimester are ectopic pregnancy, spontaneous abortion or miscarriage, postcoital bleeding, vaginal or cervical lesion, molar pregnancy, and non-obstetrical cause. Now let us see about ectopic pregnancy. It is pregnancy outside the uterine cavity. 98% of ectopic pregnancy occur in the fallopian tubes, mostly in ampulla. Risk factors include history of pelvic inflammatory disease or previous ectopic pregnancy, pelvic surgery, diethyl stilbestrol exposure in utero, intrauterine contraceptive device usage, and endometriosis. Now let us see about the clinical triad of ectopic pregnancy: amenorrhea, abdominal pain, and irregular vaginal bleeding. Now let us see about the signs of a ruptured ectopic pregnancy: hypotension, tachycardia, and rebound tenderness. Now let us see about the differential diagnosis of ectopic pregnancy. We have to rule out surgical abdomen, abortion, ovarian torsion, and ruptured ovarian cyst. Now let us see about the diagnosis of ectopic pregnancy: a positive pregnancy test with empty uterus by ultrasound, prolonged HCG doubling, progesterone less than 25 nanogram per ml. It is important that we rule out surgical abdomen before diagnosing ectopic pregnancy. Now let us see about the management of ectopic pregnancy. Methotrexate can be given when the patient is stable and when there is an unruptured ectopic pregnancy less than 3.5 cm in size and less than 6 weeks gestational age. The definitive treatment is with laparoscopic surgery. Now let us see a clinical case of ectopic pregnancy. 21-year-old female with history of pelvic inflammatory disease, presents with cramping and vaginal spotting. Physical examination shows abdominal tenderness, workup shows a positive beta HCG, and ultrasound shows an empty uterus. This is a case of ectopic pregnancy showing all the features which we have discussed. Now let us see some clinical images regarding ectopic pregnancy. This picture shows a normal pregnancy where the embryo is implanted in the uterus. This picture shows the various sites of ectopic pregnancy. The embryo can get implanted in ovary or fallopian tube. This is the most common site of ectopic pregnancy. This is a cervical ectopic pregnancy, and this is a interstitial ectopic pregnancy. This picture shows a clinical image of ectopic pregnancy. You can see the embryo is implanted in the fallopian tube. This picture shows blood in Morrison pouch, which is between the liver and kidney, due to a ruptured ectopic pregnancy. Now let us see about spontaneous abortion or miscarriage. It is loss of pregnancy before 20 weeks gestation age or delivery of fetus less than 500 gram. That is, it is loss of pregnancy before viability. In India, it is before 28 weeks of gestation age or less than 1 kilogram. Now let us see about the various types of abortion. First, let us see about threatened abortion. It is intrauterine bleeding without dilatation of cervix and no expulsion of products of conception. Now let us see about the management of threatened abortion. After documenting a live fetus, we have to advise the patient pelvic rest. In inevitable abortion, there is intrauterine bleeding with dilatation of cervix and no expulsion of products of conception. How do you treat a case of inevitable abortion? We have to do surgical evacuation of uterine contents. Now let us see a clinical case of inevitable abortion. 23-year-old primi gravida at 12 weeks gestation presents with vaginal spotting and nausea and vomiting. Physical examination shows a 3 cm cervical dilation. Ultrasound shows intrauterine pregnancy with cardiac activity. If you notice, there is bleeding and there is dilatation of cervix but no expulsion of products of conception. This is a case of inevitable abortion. We have to do surgical evacuation of uterine contents for this case. Now let us see about incomplete abortion. In this case, there is partial expulsion of products of conception. That is, there is intrauterine bleeding, there is dilatation of cervix, and there is partial expulsion of products of conception. How do you treat a case of incomplete abortion? Hospitalization and hemodynamic resuscitation, if needed, should be done, and curettage should be done. Now let us see about complete abortion. There is complete expulsion of products of conception. That is, there is intrauterine bleeding, dilatation of cervix, and complete expulsion of products of conception. No treatment is needed for complete abortion. Now let us see about missed abortion. And that is death of embryo or fetus with retention of products of conception. Treatment is with surgical evacuation of uterine contents if there is no spontaneous resolution. Now let us see about recurrent abortions. It is greater than or equal to 2 consecutive abortions or 3 total abortions. The treatment should be based on type of abortion. Now let us see about the most common cause of a first trimester fetal death. That is, the most common cause of spontaneous abortion is chromosomal abnormality. Now let us see about the signs and symptoms of spontaneous abortion. Vaginal bleeding, cramping, abdominal pain, and decreased signs and symptoms of pregnancy. Surgical evacuation of uterine contents can be done by dilatation and curettage in first trimester and dilatation and evacuation in the second trimester. This picture shows an ultrasound containing a gestational sac with a yolk sac but no embryo. This is an anembryonic gestation. This will undergo spontaneous abortion. Now let us see about antepartum and intrapartum hemorrhage. First, let us discuss the differential diagnosis of third trimester bleeding. The various differential diagnoses include placental abruption and placenta previa. A rare cause can be vasa previa. In this case, the fetus is involved. Now let us see about placental abruption. It is premature separation of normally implanted placenta. Risk factors include hypertension, increased maternal age, multiparity, African American ethnicity, preterm premature rupture of membranes, smoking, cocaine use, and trauma. Now let us see about the signs and symptoms of placental abruption. Painful bleeding, contractions, and fetal distress or death. Now let us see about the diagnosis of placental abruption. It is a clinical diagnosis. If there is a high suspicion of placenta previa, we have to do ultrasound to rule out placenta previa. Let us see about the management of placental abruption. Hemodynamic support, ROGAM, that is anti-D immunoglobulin, should be given if it is an Rh negative mother. Hospitalization. Bed rest should be advised if it is a preterm fetus. We have to do induction of mature fetuses or C-section if the fetus is unstable or the mother is unstable. Now let us see about the complications of placental abruption. Hypovolemic shock, disseminated intravascular coagulation, preterm delivery, and fetal death. Now let us see a clinical case of placental abruption. 37-year-old gravida 2 para 1 at 34 weeks of gestation, who smokes half a pack per day, presents with painful vaginal bleeding and contractions. Physical examination shows increased heart rate and uterine tenderness, and there is blood in the vaginal vault. Now let us see about placenta previa. In this case, there is implantation of placenta over cervical os. It can be complete placenta previa, as you can see in this case, or partial or marginal placenta previa, as you can see in this case. Now let us see about the risk factors for placenta previa. The risk factors include history of cesarean section, age greater than 35 years, multiparity, and smoking. The most common sign of placenta previa is painless bleeding. Remember, in placental abruption, it is painful bleeding. How do you diagnose a case of placenta previa? Ultrasound should be done to diagnose placenta previa. Now let us see about the management of placenta previa. Hemodynamic support, Rogam, that is anti-D immunoglobulin, should be given for Rh negative mothers, and expectant management. Delivery should be done by cesarean section if fetus is mature or if patient is unstable. Now let us see about the complications of placenta previa. Hypovolemic shock, preterm delivery, increased fetal anomalies, and placenta accreta. These are the various complications of placenta previa. The risk of fetal anomalies with placenta previa is 2 times more when compared to normal pregnancy. Now let us see about placenta accreta. In this case, the placenta abnormally attaches to myometrium. This picture shows a normal placenta. It attaches to the stratum basalis of endometrium. In case of placenta accreta, the placenta abnormally attaches to the myometrium. In case of placenta increta, the placenta invades the myometrium, as you can see in this case. And in case of placenta percreta, the placenta penetrates through myometrium to serosa. Now let us see about the risk factors for placenta accreta. Placenta previa, history of cesarean section, and history of curettage, gravida 6 or more. Now let us see about the signs and symptoms. Antepartum bleeding, if associated with placenta previa, otherwise patients with placenta accreta will be asymptomatic. How do you diagnose a case of placenta accreta? Ultrasound or MRI can be done. False positive can occur with both ultrasound and MRI. Now let us see about the management of placenta accreta. Uterine packing can be done to stop postpartum bleeding, or hysterectomy can be done to stop bleeding. As discussed earlier, in placenta increta, placenta invades myometrium, and in placenta percreta, the placenta penetrates through myometrium to serosa. Now let us see about vasa previa. In this case, fetal vessels pass over the internal cervical os. It will lead to cord compression and possibly rupture during pregnancy. If the fetal vessels rupture, there is around 50% fetal mortality. Now let us see about the risk factors for vasa previa. Velamentous cord insertion with multiple gestation. This picture shows vasa previa. As you can see, the fetal vessels pass over the internal cervical os. This is due to velamentous umbilical cord insertion. In this case, the vasa previa is due to multi-load placenta. In case of vasa previa, there will be sinusoidal wave tracing in non-stressed, which is associated with ruptured fetal vessel, indicating fetal anemia. This is the sinusoidal wave pattern in CTG. This indicates ruptured fetal vessels. Now let us see about the treatment of vasa previa. It is an indication for emergency cesarean section. Now let us see a case of vasa previa. 24-year-old primary gravida at 33 weeks gestation is hospitalized for polyhydramnios of unknown etiology. On examination, frontal height is greater than dates. Workup shows fetal heart rate tracing showing sinusoidal wave pattern. This is a classical case of cord prolapse. In this case, the sinusoidal wave pattern, as you can see in this picture, will be seen. Now let us see about uterine rupture. It is a rare but devastating disorder. In this case, there is bleeding associated with abdominal pain during labor. Risk factors include prior cesarean section, trauma, over-distended uterus, and abnormal placentation. Now let us see a clinical case of uterine rupture. 27-year-old G2P1 with history of prior cesarean section, attempting trial of labor after cesarean section, with change in station from +1 to +2, and loss of uterine tone seen on tochometry, and recurrent late decelerations. This is a classical case of uterine rupture. Now let us see about preterm labor. Preterm labor is labor before 37 weeks of gestation age. Risk factors for preterm labor include preterm rupture of membranes, history of preterm labor, infection, multiple gestation, uterine or fetal anomaly, preeclampsia, low socioeconomic status, and smoking. Now let us see about the clinical predictors of preterm labor. Persistent uterine contractions, fetal fibrinonectin. Fetal fibrinonectin, if it is negative, we can rule out preterm labor. Ongoing cervical dilatation greater than 3 cm or effacement greater than 80%. Vaginal bleeding and ruptured membranes. All these are clinical predictors of preterm labor. Now let us see about fetal fibrinonectin in detail. The positive predictive value for delivery within 14 days in case of fetal fibrinonectin is only 16%. However, the negative predictive value is 99%. This means that if fetal fibrinonectin is negative, we can be sure that delivery won't occur in the next 14 days. Now let us see about management of preterm labor. Hydration, empiric antibiotics if group B streptococcus status is unknown, tocolysis and steroids can be given if the fetus is between 24 to 34 weeks of gestational age or if there is a negative fetal lung maturity test between 34 to 37 weeks of gestational age. Now let us see about various tocolytic agents. The various tocolytic agents that can be used are magnesium sulfate, nifedipine, indomethacin and terbutaline. Now let us see about toxicities of magnesium sulfate. It can lead to loss of reflexes, that is deep tendon reflexes, when it is greater than 7 milliequivalent per liter. It can lead to respiratory depression when it is greater than 10 milliequivalent per liter and cardiac arrest when it is greater than 25 milliequivalent per liter. How do you treat a case of magnesium sulfate toxicity? We have to give calcium gluconate. Now let us see a clinical case of magnesium sulfate toxicity. 30-year-old G2P1 at 34 weeks of gestation presented with preterm labor and has been on magnesium sulfate for 24 hours. On examination, we see lethargy, reduced deep tendon reflexes, workup shows, ECG showing prolonged PR and QT intervals. This is a classical case of magnesium sulfate toxicity. Now let us see about toxicity of other tocolytic agents. Nifedipine can cause headache, indomethacin can cause oligohydramnios, terbutaline can cause hypoglycemia and tachycardia. These are the various adverse drug reactions of tocolytic agents. Now let us see about premature rupture of membranes. It is abbreviated as PROM. It is spontaneous rupture of membranes before onset of labor. If occurring preterm, it is called as preterm premature rupture of membranes or PPROM. PPROM, the risk of fetal pulmonary hypoplasia increases. How do you diagnose a case of premature rupture of membranes? Gush of fluid per vagina can be seen. Sterile speculum examination can be done to visualize dilatation and effacement. We have to avoid digital examination in case of PROM. This is because it can lead to infection. Positive pool, positive nitrogen test and positive ferning test indicate PROM. What is positive nitrogen test? If you add nitrogen to the vaginal fluid, you will get alkaline blue color. What is ferning test? The vaginal fluid will show a fern-like pattern when allowed to dry on a glass slide. All these indicate that there is amniotic fluid. This picture shows amniotic fluid leaking out through the cervix in case of PROM. Now let us see about the management of PROM. If there are signs of chorioamnionitis like fever, increased WBC count, maternal or fetal tachycardia, uterine tenderness, we have to treat the patient with antibiotics and delivery. Induction of labor should be done within 24 hours of PROM if there is failure to progress. How do you manage a case of premature preterm rupture of membranes? We have to do hospitalization, we have to advise bed rest and give antibiotics to prevent infection and to delay labor with or without steroids to help fetal lung maturity. Now let us see about prolonged rupture of membranes. It is defined as rupture of membranes lasting greater than 18 hours before delivery. Now let us see a clinical case of PPROM. 29-year-old primi gravida at 31 weeks of gestation presents with complaints of leaking clear fluid. She denies contractions, vaginal bleeding or fevers. Physical examination, sterile speculum examination shows pool of clear fluid in vaginal vault. Nitrogen test is blue. This is a case of PPROM showing all the features which we have discussed. Now let us see about amniotic fluid abnormalities. First let us see about oligohydramnios. It is defined as amniotic fluid index, that is AFI less than 5 or maximum vertical pocket less than 2. First let us see about amniotic fluid index or AFI. It is the total of largest vertical pockets of amniotic fluid in 4 quadrants of uterus. Now let us see about the mechanisms of oligohydramnios. It can occur due to decreased fetal urine output or due to chronic leaking through membranes. Now let us see about the conditions associated with oligohydramnios. It is associated with congenital abnormalities like renal agenesis, ruptured membranes, uteroplacental insufficiency, hypertension, diabetes mellitus, AC inhibitor use or NSAID use, postterm pregnancy and twin-to-twin transmission syndrome. Now let us see about the management of oligohydramnios. It is managed with fetal surveillance and timely delivery. Now let us see about polyhydramnios. It is defined as amniotic fluid index greater than 25 or MVP greater than 8. Now let us see about the mechanisms of polyhydramnios. It can be due to increased fetal urine output or decreased fetal swallowing and transudation of fluid from exposed meninges as in case of spina bifida. Now let us see about the conditions associated with polyhydramnios. It is associated with neural tube defects, alimentary canal defect, hydrops, diabetes mellitus and twin-to-twin transmission syndrome. Now let us see about the management of polyhydramnios, expectant management and treatment of underlying etiology like diabetes mellitus or twin-to-twin transmission syndrome. Amnioreduction can be done. PG synthetase inhibitors can be given to the patient. These include indomethacin and sulindac. Now let us see about RH incompatibility. This table shows the inheritance of RH factor. Now let us see two clinical cases. If the mother is RH negative, that is DD, and the father is RH positive, that is capital D, capital D, 100% of the offsprings will be RH positive. If the mother is RH negative and the father is RH positive but has one capital D and one small d, 50% of offsprings will be RH positive. Now let us see about development of anti-D. A RH negative mother will develop anti-D, that is she will become anti-D positive due to previous pregnancy with RH positive infant or due to blood transfusion or trauma in current pregnancy. This anti-D can cross the placenta and cause hemolysis of fetal RBCs. This will lead to severe hemolytic anemia leading to hyperdynamic state, heart failure, diffuse edema, ascites and pericardial effusion. This condition is known as erythroblastosis fetalis. ROGAM, that is anti-D immunoglobulin, can be given to a RH negative woman at risk for being pregnant with RH positive fetus. That is when RH negative woman marries a RH positive guy, she has to get ROGAM. This is given at 28 weeks even without a history of bleeding. Now let us see about the pathogenesis of erythroblastosis fetalis. This is first pregnancy of a RH negative mother with a RH positive fetus. In this case, through the placenta, the RH positive antigens react with the mother's blood leading to the formation of anti-RH antibodies which will affect the second pregnancy leading to erythroblastosis fetalis. Now let us see about multiple gestation. Dizygotic twins result due to fertilization of two ova. There is always two amnion and two chorion in case of dizygotic twins. Now let us see about monozygotic twins. It results when there is only one fertilized ovum that divides into two. Risk factors for monozygotic twins include African ethnicity, increased maternal age, increased parity and positive family history. Now let us see about dichorionic diamniotic twins. They are also known as di-di twins. They occur when there is division 2 to 3 days after conception, that is before trophoblastic differentiation. This picture shows the formation of dichorionic diamnetic twins. This occurs when the morula cleaves at around days 1 to 3. Now let us see what the ultrasound findings of dichorionic diamnetic twins. There will be two placentas, twin peak sign and thick intertwin membrane. Now let us see what monochorionic diamnetic twins. Since there is only one chorion, there will be only one placenta. This occurs when there is division 3 to 8 days after conception. This picture shows the formation of a monochorionic diamnetic twins. It occurs when the blastocyst cleaves at around days 4 to 8. Now let us see what monochorionic monoamnionic twins. Obviously there will be only one placenta. It occurs when there is division at around 8 to 13 days after conception. This picture shows monochorionic monoamnionic twins. It occurs due to cleavage of implanted blastocyst at around days 8 to 13. Conjoined twins can form when there is division at around 13 to 15 days, that is after formation of embryonic disc. And this picture shows formation of conjoined twins. This is due to cleavage of formed embryonic disc at around days 13 to 15. Now let us see about ultrasound findings of dichorionic diamnetic twins. This picture shows ultrasound of a dichorionic diamnetic twin at around 13 weeks of gestation. This is the twin peak sign or lambda sign. Now let us see about ultrasound findings of monochorionic diamnetic twins at 12 weeks gestation. This picture shows a thin intertwin membrane, and also if you notice there is only one placenta in this case. Now let us see about signs and symptoms of multiple gestation. The uterus will be larger than dates. There will be excessive maternal weight gain, hydramnios or unexplained maternal anemia. On auscultation we can find more than one fetal heart sound. There will usually be history of ovulation induction or in vitro fertilization. This is a major risk factor for multiple gestation. Multiple gestation should be confirmed by ultrasound. Now let us see about twin to twin transmission syndrome. It is a major complication of monochorionic twins. It occurs when the arterial circulation of one twin is in communication with the venous circulation of the other twin. The clinical features of donor twin are anemia, growth restriction and oligohydramnios. The clinical features in the recipient twin are polycythemia, hypervolemia, cardiomegaly and congestive heart failure. Now let us see about delivery of multiple gestation. If the first twin is vertex and second twin is not significantly larger, then we can do trial of labor. Otherwise we have to do cesarean section. That is, if the first twin is not in vertex, we have to do cesarean section. Now let us see about postterm pregnancy. The most common cause of postterm pregnancy is inaccurate dating. Postterm pregnancy is associated with anencephaly and adrenal hypoplasia. Now let us see about fetal diagnostic testing and monitoring. Let us see about prenatal genetic analysis of a fetus. The indications for prenatal genetic analysis are advanced maternal age, positive family history for a genetic deformity, or previous child with chromosomal abnormality. Fetal abnormality on ultrasound, abnormal serum marker screening and unexplained intrauterine growth restriction. Now let us see about screening tests for prenatal diagnosis of genetic abnormalities. We can do sequential screen, which is first trimester nuchal translucency with blood test plus second trimester blood test. Quadruple screen is done during second trimester. Now let us see about nuchal translucency. It is done at around 10 to 14 weeks. Quadruple screen includes maternal serum alpha beta protein, estriol, human chorionic gonadotropin and inhibin A. Now let us see about the differential diagnosis of maternal serum alpha beta protein elevation. It is elevated in case of neural tube defect, inaccurate dating, multiple gestation, fetal abdominal wall defect and fetal death. Now let us see a clinical case to understand fetal diagnostic testing. 39-year-old G2P1 at 18 weeks gestation presents for routine prenatal care visit. Physical examination is consistent with 18 week pregnancy. Triple screen shows reduced alpha beta protein and estriol and elevated beta HCG. Ultrasound shows thickened nuchal skin and short femurs. These findings are suggestive of Down syndrome. In Down syndrome, the quadruple screen will show reduced alpha beta protein and estriol, elevated beta HCG and elevated inhibin A. Nuchal translucency will be thickened, that is, there will be thickened nuchal skin. Now let us see about fetal karyotype. This can be done using amniocentesis, chorionic villus sampling or CVS, and percutaneous umbilical blood sampling or PUBS. Amniocentesis is done between 16 to 21 weeks of gestational age. There is a 1 in 250 chance of complications. Now let us see about chorionic villus sampling. It is done between 9 to 11 weeks of gestational age. The risk of complication is 0.5 to 1%. A rare complication of chorionic villus sampling is limb reduction defects. Chorionic villus sampling offers prenatal genetic diagnosis in the first trimester itself and allows earlier and safer pregnancy termination if desired. Now let us see about cardiocentesis. It is also known as percutaneous umbilical blood sampling. We can do karyotype, we can estimate fetal hematocrit, platelet count and fetal blood type using cardiocentesis. How do you assess fetal lung maturity? For this, we have to do amniocentesis and then we have to determine lecithin sphingomyelin ratio. If it is greater than 2, the lung is mature. Presence of phosphatidyl glycerol in amniotic fluid also indicates a mature fetal lung. This picture shows amniocentesis. As you can see, with the help of ultrasound, we take a sample of amniotic fluid. This picture shows chorionic villus sampling. As you can see, with the help of ultrasound, we take a sample from the chorionic villus. This picture shows cardiocentesis. As you can see, with the help of ultrasound, we take a sample from the umbilical cord. Now let us see about non-stress test. What are the features of a reactive non-stress test? Greater than or equal to 2 accelerations, that is, increased heart rate, each greater than or equal to 15 beats per minute above the baseline for greater than or equal to 15 seconds, all within 20 minutes. This is the feature of non-stress test, that is, reactive non-stress test. This picture shows a reactive non-stress test. There are accelerations of greater than 15 beats per minute lasting for greater than or equal to 15 seconds with each fetal movement. Now let us see about biophysical profile. It is abbreviated as BPP. A mnemonic to remember the components of biophysical profile is test the baby man. T for tone, B for breathing, M for movement, A for amniotic fluid index, and N for non-stress test. Let us see about tone. Greater than or equal to 1 episode of extension of limb with return to flexion or opening and closing of hand. If it is present, a score of plus 2 is given. Let us see about breathing. Greater than or equal to 1 episode of rhythmic breathing lasting greater than or equal to 30 seconds. If it is present, a score of plus 2 is given. Let us see about gross movement. Greater than or equal to 3 discrete body or limb movements. If it is present, a score of plus 2 is given. Amniotic fluid. If a single vertical pocket greater than or equal to 2 is present, a score of plus 2 is given. A reactive NST is given, a score of plus 2. Biophysical profile is indicated when the NST is non-reactive or equivocal. The normal score is 8 to 10. We have to add all these, and if it is between 8 to 10, the baby is supposed to be normal. Now let us see about normal labor and delivery. Braxton Hicks contractions are also known as false labor. These are irregular contractions not associated with cervical dilatation or effacement. Labor is regular uterine contractions that cause progressive cervical dilatation or effacement. How do you detect rupture of membranes on vaginal examination? Positive pooling, phoning test and nitrosyn test, as discussed earlier, indicate rupture of membranes. Positive pooling has a very low sensitivity for detecting rupture of membranes. Nitrogen test can be false positive when there is blood, semen, and in case of vaginitis. The most common fetal presentation is vertex, occiput anterior. Now let us see about Bishop score. It is assessed by cervical examination. If the Bishop score is greater than or equal to 9, it is favorable for induction. Now let us see about the components of Bishop score. A mnemonic to remember the components of Bishop score is call PEDS. C for consistency of cervix. The score is 0 when the cervix is firm. Score is 1 when the consistency is average. And the score is 2 when the cervix is soft. Now let us see about the position of cervix in vagina. The score is 0 when the cervix is posterior. The score is 1 when the cervix is mid position, and the score is 2 when the cervix is in anterior position. Now let us see about the effacement. The score is 0 when the effacement is 0 to 30%. The score is 1 when the effacement is 40 to 50%, and the score is 2 when the effacement is 60 to 70%, and the score of 3 is given when the effacement is greater than or equal to 80%. D stands for dilatation of cervix. The score is 0 when the dilatation is less than 1 cm. Score is 1 when the dilatation is 1 to 2 cm. Score is 2 when the dilatation is 3 to 4 cm. And the score is 3 when the dilatation is greater than or equal to 5 cm. S stands for station, which is related to ischial spine. Score is 0 when the station is -3. Score is 1 when the station is -2. Score is 2 when the station is -1 or 0. And the score is 3 when the station is +1 or +2. We have to add all these, and if the total score is greater than or equal to 9, it is favorable for induction. Now let us see about progression of labor. First let us see about cardinal movements of labor. The cardinal movements of labor are engagement, descent, flexion, internal rotation, extension, external rotation, that is restitution and expulsion. And let us discuss about stages of labor. First stage is from onset of labor to full cervical dilatation, that is 10 cm. It has two phases, latent phase and active phase. Latent phase is from onset of labor to around 4 cm cervical dilatation. Active phase is from 4 cm dilatation to around 10 cm cervical dilatation. This dilatation is rapid. Now let us see about second stage of labor. It is from complete cervical dilatation to delivery of infant. Third stage is from delivery of infant to delivery of placenta. Third stage should be less than 30 minutes. Let us see about signs of placental separation, rising and firming of uterus, gush of blood, and umbilical cord lengthening are all signs of placental separation. Now let us see about vaginal laceration, which is a complication of vaginal delivery. First degree laceration involves the skin or mucosa. Second degree laceration involves the fascia and muscles of perineal body. Third degree laceration involves the anal sphincter. Fourth degree laceration involves the anal mucosa exposing lumen of rectum. Now let us see a clinical case. 25-year-old primi gravida who just delivered a 3.5 kg baby continues to have vaginal bleeding after delivery of placenta. Physical examination shows vaginal laceration dissecting the perineum with an intact anal sphincter. This is an example of second degree laceration. It involves the perineum, but the anal sphincter is intact. Now let us see about intrapartum fetal assessment. Normal fetal heart rate is between 120 to 160 beats per minute. Now let us see about the differential diagnosis of fetal bradycardia, that is fetal heart rate less than 120 beats per minute. It can be caused due to fetal distress, local anesthetics, and congenital heart block, which is seen with maternal systemic lobus erythematosus. Now let us see about the differential diagnosis for fetal tachycardia, that is fetal heart rate greater than 160 beats per minute. It can be seen with fetal infection or arrhythmia, maternal fever, anxiety, or thyrotoxicosis. It can also occur due to turbidity, fetal movement, and stimulation. As discussed earlier, a reactive fetal heart rate raising has greater than or equal to 2 accelerations, that is T shape in the heart rate, each greater than or equal to 15 beats per minute above the baseline for greater than or equal to 15 seconds, all within 20 minutes. Now let us discuss decelerations. Early deceleration is symmetric deceleration that begins and ends at around the same time as contractions. It looks like mirror image of contraction. It is due to head compression stimulating vagus nerve. It is normal and requires no intervention. This picture shows early deceleration. If you notice, it is a symmetric deceleration. It begins and ends around the time of contraction, and it looks like a mirror image of contraction. Remember, it is due to head compression stimulating vagus nerve. Now let us see what variable deceleration. It is the most common abnormal deceleration. It is a sharp drop and return to baseline, often preceded and followed by an acceleration. It can occur at any time. That is, it has no relation with the uterine contractions. It is due to cord compression. This picture shows variable deceleration. It has no relation to the uterine contraction. It is due to cord compression. It is abnormal and it requires intervention depending on its severity. Now let us see about late deceleration. It begins at the peak of a contraction and slowly returns to baseline after the end of a contraction. It is due to uteroplacental insufficiency. It is the most worrisome deceleration and requires intervention if it becomes repetitive. This picture shows a late deceleration. As you can see, it begins at the peak of the contraction and slowly returns to baseline after the end of a contraction. Now let us see a clinical case. 32-year-old gravidated to para 1 at 37 weeks gestation, presence in labor. Physical examination shows active phase of first stage of labor. Fetal heart rate is 130 beats per minute. Tracing shows shallow symmetrical decelerations, which are like mirror image of each contraction. This is an example of early deceleration, which is due to fetal head compression. Remember, it is normal and no intervention is needed. Now let us see about scalp pH. It is necessary to estimate scalp pH to detect if adequate oxygen is reaching the fetal brain. It can be detected using fetal scalp blood sampling or by scalp stimulation. In this we do digital stroking of fetal scalp that evokes an acceleration which suggests normal scalp pH. Now let us see about abnormal labor and delivery. First let us see about induction. Induction is initiating labor in a non-laboring patient. Indications for induction can be divided into maternal indications and fetal indications. Maternal indications are preeclampsia and diabetes mellitus. Fetal indications are chorioamnionitis, intrauterine growth restriction, postterm pregnancy and hydrops. Now let us see about cervical maturation or ripening. It improves induction results. Methods used to promote cervical ripening are prostaglandin gel or prostaglandin insert and intrauterine Foley balloon. Now let us see about the methods to induce labor. Labor can be induced by oxytocin or amniotomy, which is artificial rupture of membranes. Now let us see about the complications associated with oxytocin. Uterine hyperstimulation. If this occurs, we have to stop oxytocin. We have to ask the patient to lie in left lateral position and we have to give oxygen to the patient. Water intoxication can occur. It can be prevented with strict input-output management. Now let us see about augmentation. Augmentation is strengthening contractions in a laboring patient. Methods for augmentation include oxytocin and amniotomy. Prior to amniotomy, we have to confirm engagement of fetal head into maternal pelvis. Now let us see about dystocia. Dystocia is also known as difficult labor. It can be due to abnormalities of power, passenger or passage. Difficult labor can be due to poor uterine contractility and poor maternal expulsive effort. Coming to the fetal causes of difficult labor, mal presentation, breech presentation, shoulder impaction and hydrocephalus can lead to difficult labor. Coming to the passage, the labor will be difficult when there is an android and platyploid pelvic types. It will be difficult in case of uterine fibroid. Now let us see about breech presentation. It is also known as buttock presentation. Let us see the types of breech presentation. Frank breech, complete breech and footling breech. Frank breech is the most common breech. This picture shows a frank breech. As you can see, the hips are flexed and the knees are extended. The feet are near the fetal head. This picture shows a complete breech. In complete breech, the hips are flexed and the knees are flexed. The feet are near the breech. This picture shows a footling breech. It is the least common. In footling breech, one or two hips are extended and at least one foot is below the breech, as you can see in this case. Now let us see about the management of breech presentation. For a full term breech and a laboring patient, usually C-section should be done. Other treatment options for breech presentation include external cephalic version and trial of vaginal delivery. This should be done before full term. Now let us see about a clinical case of breech presentation. 28-year-old G3B2, presents a term in labor. Physical examination shows fetal head at top of fundus by Leopold manoeuvres. Ultrasound shows breech presentation with both feet near the fetal head. This is a case of frank breech. Now let us see about shoulder dystocia. It is impaction of shoulder behind pubic symphysis after delivered head. Risk factors for shoulder dystocia include macrosomia, gestational diabetes mellitus, maternal obesity and postterm delivery. Now let us see about the fetal complications of shoulder dystocia. It can lead to fracture of humerus or clavicle. There can be brachial plexus injury like Erb's palsy, hypoxia and fetal death. Now let us see about the manoeuvres to displace the shoulder impaction. Suprapubic pressure can be given, that is pressure on the maternal abdomen behind pubic symphysis. McRoberts maneuver can be done. This is sharp flexion of maternal hips, as you can see in this picture. They are giving sharp flexion of maternal hips to displace the impacted shoulder. Rubin maneuver can be done. It is pressure on accessible shoulder, pushing it towards anterior chest and decreasing shoulder-shoulder diameter, as you can see in this picture. Delivery of posterior shoulder can be done. In this case, we sweep posterior shoulder across chest, delivering arm, and then we rotate shoulder girdle to oblique diameter of pelvis, as you can see in this picture. Wood's corkscrew maneuver. In this case, we give pressure on the posterior shoulder, rotating it in a corkscrew fashion, as you can see in this picture. Last resort for displacing the shoulder include fracture of clavicle and Zavanelli maneuver. In Zavanelli maneuver, we replace infant's head back in the pelvis and perform cesarean section. Now let's see about the most common indications for cesarean section. Prior cesarean section, labor dystocia, fetal distress and breech presentation. Now let us see about VBAC. It is vaginal birth after cesarean section. It is also known as trial of labor after cesarean section. It can be done when the previous cesarean section is a low transverse, low vertical incision. A complication of vaginal birth after cesarean section is uterine rupture. We have discussed this earlier. Now let us see about postpartum complications. First let us see about postpartum hemorrhage. It is loss of greater than 500 ml of blood after completion of third stage of labor. Causes of postpartum hemorrhage include uterine atony, retained placenta, cervical or vaginal laceration. Now let us see about risk factors for uterine atony. It can be due to uterine overdistension caused by multiple gestation, hydramnios, that is polyhydramnios and macrosomia. Other risk factors include multiparity, general anesthesia and history of postpartum hemorrhage. Now let us see about the management of postpartum hemorrhage. First we have to do uterine massage, then we have to give drugs like oxytocin or methogen or prostaglandin. Then we have to explore the uterus for retained placenta and we have to explore cervix and vagina for lacerations. If it is still not controlled, we have to do surgical interventions like postpartum dilatation and curettage, uterine artery embolization and hysterectomy. Now let us see a clinical case of postpartum hemorrhage. 40-year-old G4P3 who just delivered twins followed by two whole placentas now has copious vaginal bleeding. Physical examination reveals around 800 ml of blood loss in 5 minutes and boggy uterus. This is a case of uterine atony causing postpartum hemorrhage. Now let us see about postpartum endometritis. The clinical features include fever greater than or equal to 38 degrees Celsius, that is greater than or equal to 100.4 degree Fahrenheit within 36 hours of delivery, uterine tenderness and malodorous loci. Risk factors include delivery by cesarean section, low socioeconomic status, young age, prolonged ruptured membrane, bacterial colonization of lower genital tract and steroids. How do you treat a case of postpartum endometritis? we have to give broad spectrum antibiotics until the patient is afebrile for 24 hours. Now let us see a clinical case of postpartum endometritis, 23-year-old with history of uncontrollable type 1 diabetes mellitus, presents one day after cesarean section with fever. On examination, you find the temperature to be 38.8 degrees Celsius, that is 102 degree Fahrenheit, there is uterine tenderness and malodorous loci. On a laboratory investigations reveal WBC count of 16,000 cells per millimeter cube, urine analysis and urine culture are negative. This is a classical case of postpartum endometritis showing the features which we have discussed. Now let us see about the contraception which we can use for breastfeeding women. We can advise progesterone only pills, Depo Provera, Mirena or copper intermittent device and Implanon for women during breastfeeding. Now let us see about postpartum psychologic reactions. There are two types, postpartum depression and postpartum blues. First let us see about postpartum depression. It is mild to suicidal depression that begins at around 4 weeks postpartum and can last up to 1 year postpartum. It may affect up to 20% of postpartum mothers. Edinburgh depression scale can be used for clinical assessment of postpartum depression. The other type is maternity or postpartum blues. In this case, there will be transient symptoms of depression that usually resolve by postpartum day 10. It may affect up to 70% of postpartum mothers. It is more common, but it is less serious. Now let us see a clinical case of postpartum depression. 17-year-old single female who is 7 months postpartum now presents with 6 month history of weight loss, insomnia and dysphoria, that is clinical features of depression. On examination, you notice poor attention to personal appearance. Workup reveals thyroid function test to be within normal limit. This is a classical case of postpartum depression. If you have any suggestions, please let me know in the comment section. This is just a review video of obstetrics. I have made separate videos on important topics. You can check them out in the obstetric playlist. If you like my videos, kindly subscribe. Your subscription will encourage me to make more videos. Thank you.